Hi guys, welcome back to my channel. It's Yvonne from Ginger Chick Rehab. Today's video, I will be bringing you some thrift flips. If you are new to our channel, this is something I do along with my husband, Chris. We take thrift store finds, we take the unwanted, unloved, outdated items and give them new life. And we share our vision and the process of what we do to these items here on this channel. And we are blessed to be able to sell them here locally. We have a couple booths in a local antique mall. So in today's video, I am sharing the process of the flipped items that are some bowls and some risers and some trays. And I am just sharing with you what my vision for these items are. And I do have a couple little Hobby Lobby and a couple Target pickup. And I just want to show you when you're out and you know they're on sale and they're cheap enough, what you could do to an item just to give it a little bit more something. I don't really just like turning something around and reselling it. I always like to give it my own little spin.
So when I'm out thrifting, I'm always looking for some added decorative pieces, some pieces that you can add decor into, and even pieces and parts to make decor. So I'm always looking for bowls and trays and risers and what I can do to them. Can I add some feet to them? Can I add a candlestick to them? Do they have a lazy Susan? Do they spin around? What can I do with these items? And these little wooden troughs right in front were a 50% off a Hobby Lobby find. And those two-tier trays were a $5 Target dollar spot find. And so I thought I would go ahead and share what my vision of these items is. So of course, you know, the first thing I do is go through and take any of the stickers off, any price tag, any tags that says like, yep, this was a Hobby Lobby, but that's okay. It's now a Ginger Chick. I am going to transform it into something a little bit better. It's very, very raw. And yep, they are now yours. You thrifted them, you purchased them, you're going to put your own little spin on them. So get rid of all those price tags and all those store tags because they are now your item. So I actually had just planned on doing these little $5 two-tier risers from the Target dollar spot on their own. So I'd already glued and ordered these knobs. There was a pack of 14 off of Amazon. I like these wooden knobs. I liked them that they were a little bit longer for knobs for me. I thought they looked more like feet and the price was perfect. I have them down in my description box and just perfect for what I need for these pieces and parts that I wanted to put together to make into some decor risers. And that candlestick, just a little short candlestick and a little round wooden piece, were perfect. And so now I'm just taking some E6000, and that is a nice strong bond, but it takes a little bit of time to dry. For a quicker bond, I'm going to add a little bit of this Star Bond CA glue just so I know that it's not going to move around. But I am just going to let them sit for hours and let glue do what glue does and glue the two things together. Yes, I know you can use hot glue, but sometimes I find that the hot glue kind of rises the item up, and I want to make sure that these legs do not come off. As always, don't forget to stick your glue tips in a little bit of Vaseline so that lid does not glue onto that bottle. So now I have this tray that I thrifted and it has a piece of glass. So I need to remove the back. I need to be able to paint these separately. I love that when I thrifted it, I did look to see if I could remove this back, and I could. That way that I can stick my own design, my own Ginger Chick Rehab design in it. So I do have a few items that need to be sanded. These two Lazy Susans, I absolutely love when I run across Lazy Susans, but they're not that they fit into the Ginger Chick theme. Somebody would not be looking for an item like this in my booth. They would be coming looking for a black or white item. So this is something, unfortunately, that needs to be sanded off. Remember, it was unwanted. It was at a thrift store. So Chris is helping me out by sanding all those paint jobs off. And then when it comes to this flower, this had epoxy on top of it and it was chipping, so that was going to be a workout. Then he took the orbital sander and much of these trays that he could, these little dough bowl decorative pieces, and now I'm just going in on that curved. Sometimes when you're trying to do that with the orbital sander, it is such a light wood that if you went in too hot and heavy, you might take away too much of the wood. Now, I believe that I have all the pieces detagged. I have everything taken apart, the items that needed to be sanded, and the items that needed to be glued already. So now I can get them all cleaned up. And I just absolutely love using the Super Clean, even crud cutter. I like a product that you can just wipe on and then wipe off and then no rinsing required. And if I could suggest anything, make sure that you just squeeze your rag out a lot, especially on that raw wood. You don't want anything to raise the grain of your wood up. You know, wood does not necessarily always like to be super wet. So you're just getting these to be clean, not soaking them. So now I have these couple items, this tray along with the riser, that are just that raw wood. And I just know that as soon as I go to paint it, all the paint's going to do is just suck right in. So I'm going to give them a couple coats so that they can get a little bit better of a paint job. Then along with this piece also, that's what happened with this piece. It was so dry, so then when it was manufacturer painted, all it did was the paint just soaked right in. So if I put a couple coats of the shellac on there, that'll stop it from doing that. And then on the back of that tray that had that glass, it is just this particle board, and you can see that there had been a stain. It had got some kind of a liquid on it. I don't know what it was. It doesn't really matter. I am going to paint over it, but I'm going to seal that area in also, and the whole entire back of the board. I don't want it to be seeping through on the finished product that I'm going to be doing. And if I'm already doing some other ones in the shellac, why not go ahead and do this one too? Like I said, I don't know if that will seep through or not, but I'd rather seal it in. Now, though Chris could sand off the epoxy and the flower design on the top of this Lazy Susan, the one thing that you could not do is go on those sides. Those sides still have that flower shape, but they are purple, so that's not really the ginger chick color. So I just taped off the bottom using some Dollar Tree masking tape, and now I'm just going to go in with some Waverly ink chalk paint and just gingerly go in and paint over that purple. I did not. It wasn't epoxy over it. It was just soaked into that raw wood. So the nice thing about this ink color, it covers in one coat. And I know I could have painted these little feet without them being glued on, but I was already in the process of gluing them all on. So yep, I just had to tape around them. This board for a dollar from Habitat was in perfect shape. I am not going to touch this board other than putting some kind of stencil on it, but I do want these little feet that are so raw, I want to paint them white. So I'm just going in with some Waverly white chalk paint. So for some of these items, they are going to be black, and some of them are going to have, that's going to be their undercoat. So for this wooden bowl, this bowl was so pretty and it has so many details, but it was used and abused. So to get the nice smooth coverage on it, I think it's a wood, but it also kind of reminds me of a resin. I'm not positive on it. But so what I'm doing here is I'm taking some Rust-Oleum Paint and Primer 1 in a flat black, and I am spraying this entire bowl. And then actually, oddly enough, I have four other bowls that I need to get painted up also. I have actually not come across wooden bowls in a long time, so I was happy to come across these. So yes, to get the smoothest finish and to stop it from dripping, the spray paint is a nice way to start these all off. And then for this tray, this is definitely the MDF board. To get the smoothest coverage on this, I'm going to be doing the same thing, just using this Rust-Oleum flat black. So if you are new to our channel and this is your first time watching, we are blessed. We live in Michigan. We are blessed to have a spray room when we built our workshop. Not even a year ago, this was one of the areas we knew was going to be a necessity. And then I thrifted this turntable, and boy, has it come in handy. We just take pieces of wood, and that way we can spray them, turn around at 360, have a spray room that's ventilated, and then able to do mass produce pieces like this. Bring one in, spray one, and then the boards are so nice. If I can suggest anything, thrifting a turntable for a couple bucks, cutting some extra pieces of wood. So if you are a reseller like me and you want to get multiple items done, This is so helpful. Now for this item that I glued that little candlestick on, I'm going to be painting it black first. So I have to go in. I don't want the base to be, I want to keep that natural wood color. I like the color of that. I know this is a little oak round, but not a fan of the golden color. So I'm going to be just going in with that Waverly ink chalk paint and giving an undercoat of black. And then for these little Target $5 tier trays, I love the price. For me, that is a great starting point. For some people, that might have been a finished item, but that wood is raw. It will stain up. You'll see water drops. So that is not something that, to me, I look at it as a hobby piece that I can finish this up. So I'm going in on the bottom of each one of these trays, and I'm using that Waverly and ink also. And then I'll carry that Waverly ink paint all the way to those little knobbies that I painted as feet. So before flipping these items over to get the other side, I am going to seal that black paint in using some polycrylic. I just find that one, it gives it a nice finish and it keeps that paint there. So when I go to some of these items will be white and I will be distressing them, so that when I go to distress them, I'm just distressing down to that polycrylic and that black is going to show through. And then for some of these items that are going to be staying black, this is going to be their finished top coat. And then about an hour or so later, depending on your humidity, that these are ready to be flipped over. And now I can do that exact same process. I can take them back into the spray room. I can spray the area with the Rust-Oleum that has not already been spray painted. And then when that's dry, I can finish them up with the polycrylic also. So for this Lazy Susan turntable, I had painted this in that ink chalk paint also. And then I polycrylicked it. But I did not want to paint the underneath. I wanted to leave that as is. So now I'm going in with some of that Waverly white chalk paint and giving it a couple coats. I want this to be white. I'm going to be putting a stencil on it. So I taped off the bottom where I didn't want paint to go. And as you see, there again, I have another turntable. This is just a game changer. It just helps so much when you want to do that 360 that you're not trying to work around a piece or touch the piece too often and get fingerprints on it. I do find for this Waverly white chalk paint that right from the get-go, these Waverly paints, if I start right off by watering them down, the consistency is a little bit better. Sometimes I do pour out a little too much water and have to add more paint, but I definitely am loving this for my smaller items that I am hand painting. And then even though I earlier suggested using that turntable, there I was picking that item up, not putting that onto, but I was not going to make the mistake with my next piece. Hello, grab the turntable, put it underneath your board. That's what it's for. Even I do that. Even I just get into the motion, I get going, and then I'm like, oh shoot, now I gotta, I just wanted to finish painting it, and then I put it on the next one. Do you all do that? Just, you know, something that you need to do, but you're like, I'm already in the process, I'm gonna finish it up, and I'll do it on the next one. So yes, when I move on to coat number two, I'm still keeping that paint watered down, and the brushes that I'm using for this chalk paint are a very, very light, I don't even know how to explain them, almost just silk-like bristles, and they just make a very smooth paint job. So keeping that watered down just will give you a smooth finish, and if you're looking for a different texture, then don't water it down and use a different brush. It just depends on what texture you're looking for. And then after I get the backside, then I can flip them over and start doing the front side. I have to say the nice thing, I do find that this Waverly chalk paint does dry pretty fast. And one tip that I learned from all of you is get that paint on there, get it dry, because you don't want it to set up overnight and have to try to sand it or distress it. So this is a process for me that I need to get it all done in one day when I want to distress this white. So I will admit that some of it was taking a little bit longer to dry, so I did get out my heat gun. And I just have to giggle because I've had the stamping up heat gun for decades, I think. And I probably have used it more in our workshop than I ever used it for card making. Well, I will say, since I seem to be rushing the process to get this dry, it is dry to the touch, but that does not mean it's cured. And since I use these boards a lot, I don't want any of that black paint coming off on this board. So all I did was tear off a little piece of paper to set underneath it, so that way it wasn't getting any of that black paint from when I've spray painted this. And I really be doing the same thing. This is just something I had learned over time when I had flipped the white paint over, that it was kind of getting marked up, and I realized that it was coming from the black paint on the boards I had. Though it's nice to carry the boards back and forth from the spray room, never thinking that the black paint was going to get on my white items. So the fix is dollar store paper and just rip some pieces off, and if it's dry, it's not going to stick. So really, it only took a couple coats to cover these items. I did go back through and touch up a third coat where I felt that it needed to be. So now that these items are dry, and yeah, maybe I helped them a little bit with the heat gun. Like I said, this is a process for me to want to distress these pieces, that I need to get it all done in one day. And I do the mass quantities because of reselling and thrifting almost every day. I do not like to have a stockpile of stuff that's left unfinished. That's just what works for me and Chris. So I'm going in with some sandpaper first, and because this piece is real wood, it's the way that it absorbs it differently. And then I'll come back through and then water distress it a little bit more. But I think it doesn't matter whichever way you want to do it. If you wanted to water distress it first and then sandpaper, or sandpaper then water distress, or not water distress at all. It's just whatever process you guys have all taught me this, and so I'm just figuring out what's working the best for me. And then for me also, I like a smoother finish, so then I just take that wet rag over the entire piece and make it nice and smooth. Like I said, this chalk paint you can leave textured if you want, but for me, I like it a little bit smoother. So it's the same process. I'll go in with the sandpaper on those sharp edges and get that distress where I want it to be, and then go back in with that wet damp rag and then distress a little bit more and smooth out that paint. And then to seal my chalk paint in on my white items, my go-to is this Varathane finishing wax in a natural. We get it at the Home Depot. I know whatever natural wax you want to use. I tried the Waverly one that was supposed to go with it, but it tended to remove some of the chalk paint. So I decided that that was not the look that I was going for, because I had already kind of controlled where I wanted to distress. I didn't want it to be distressed anymore. So were you wondering if I was going to have any black items in this grouping? Oh yes, I had two of these little bowls, so of course I had to make one white and I make one black. So I had sealed that in with that polycrylic, remember? And so I'm just going in with some 220 sandpaper and hitting all of the hard edges on this piece too, to get down to that natural wood. And I'm going back in with some fine grit steel wool, and oh, I can just tell you how smooth this piece went. It went from a very rough and raw piece, and it is just absolutely a nice smooth piece already, just with doing this steel wool on it. And yes, for this Katie Brown bowl, I was going to be leaving this black also. So I was trying to figure out how to tackle this bad boy. This has got a lot of areas where I'm going to need to sand. So first I go in on the bottom and I'm just trying to hit the edges, though it's not a straight edge. So I did go through it on the bottom with the 220 sandpaper, but then quickly switched over to my steel wool to just sand the piece and just use the elbow grease to get it to be removed. The sand paper on the sides just kind of was scratching it too much because it's not a flat surface that you can really go at. After getting the bottom of this painted, I absolutely loved how it turned out, but I wasn't a fan. I love the wood. You know, wood is very much in right now, but I don't like the little stain, that manufacturer stain that they put on these pieces. So I'm just going in and trying to remove as much of that and get that down to that, just that raw wood that's underneath here. Did you wonder how I was going to finish off the top of these $5 Target dollar spot finds? Yep, you guessed it. I'm going to put some antiquing wax on this. This is a very raw wood, so it's just going to soak it right in. And so I'm just going to very gingerly be putting this on. Then for the rest of the pieces that I had sanded and distressed that are black, they are also getting this Waverly antiquing wax. I am just absolutely obsessed with what this antiquing wax does to black paint. After that Waverly wax had dried and cured a little bit, I'm going in and sealing it in with some polycrylic. And then I'd already done that to the bottom of these also when I was doing the polycrylic on the rest of the pieces. That way that this will have longevity, everything is sealed in. This is the bottom to the tray that has the glass. And I had ordered this decoupage paper off of thescrapbook.com. And I was hoping that it was going to be the exact size that I needed to cover the entire piece. But unfortunately, it was a little bit shy of that. So after playing with some of my stamps, I got the pig, I got some of the Paris stamps, and I decided that I really am drawn to the rabbit for this one. Now I tried it first on the brown paper and I didn't really like it. It didn't do anything for the stamp, I felt. So white it is. So after cutting the paper down to fit the exact size of the length of this tray bottom, I'm going to be Mod Podging it on. Now, the decoupage paper is thicker than a tissue paper, so it's not like I could have put it on the back. I guess I could have put it on the board, but I wanted to kind of work it in sections so that it didn't shift. I know you do have a little bit of time with it. So it was going right through as I was putting it on the top anyway. It's very porous. So now I'm just taking some of the Waverly antiquing wax and I'm just running it around the edge of this before I attach it on to this frame. So I'm trying to decide which way I want to go before I permanently attach it. Do I want it here? Do I want it there? Do I want it off-centered? Do I want it crooked? Oh, so many decisions once I finally stick this poor little bunny down. So now I just added some more Mod Podge to the back of the little bunny and I'm going to center him to my eye. And really, I'm just eyeing it here. And yep, I'm just going to keep him nice and straight. And then I'm going to run a little bit of the Mod Podge back over it. And this is why I put that on the edge. I just wanted the antiquing wax to see what that would do if I Mod Podged it on the sides and see if it was kind of would blend it all together anyway. And then I just took a wet wipe and I'm going to go around and add a little bit more. Yep, that wasn't enough. And then I wanted to take a little bit of the paper. When I purchased it, I thought it was going to have a little bit more brown to it, but it was pretty white and I want to antique this a little bit. So would it be my channel if I didn't somehow figure out how to throw a green sack stripe in? So yep, this little Lazy Susan's going to get a green sack stripe right in the middle. So I'm using my half inch tape on this one because I don't want to have too big of a green sack stripe to overwhelm it. And yes, I probably could have cut it out of my Cricut and do vinyl, but actually I think the tape is cheaper than the vinyl. So I'm just finding center. Making sure for this one, I want it to be centered because of it being a round object or just what I'm doing. That's the nice thing about grain sack striping. Even if it wasn't centered, it would still be okay. But for this one, I'm looking for center. So then I'm going to take another piece of tape and I'm going to lay one on the one side, butt it right up against, and I'm going to go down the sides of the round. And then I'm going to do the exact same thing. We're going to take another piece of tape and I'm going to go on the other side. And then I'm going to pull up that middle tape, that first piece of tape I laid, and that is where my paint stripe is going to go. So I'm really rubbing on that tape to make sure that it is good and adhered. And so my first paint color for this is going to be a light gray. This is an Apple Barrel multi-use paint, and it's just a light gray. I think it's called Timeless Gray. I get it at Walmart. I am doing that dry sponge technique where there's just a little bit of paint on my makeup sponge, and I will go over this 3 times, letting it dry in between coats. When I said I let it dry in between coats, I actually meant I take a blow dryer and help it along. Now, since that was a half inch stripe, I'm taking my bigger size masking tape that's an inch, and I am just centering it so there's a little bit of gap over on each side, making sure that each side has pretty much the same amount of gap. And so then that is where the in between of the next paint stripe will go, and then I can butt up another paint just like before, where I put one piece of tape on one side, one piece of tape on the other side. That's the nice thing about masking tape, because you can see right through it. Doing the exact same thing with the paint. Drying it in between coats and about 3 coats to cover. So I left the original tape on underneath, so that way when I'm painting my stripe, I didn't have to worry about it going over onto this tape. And I'll just take a little bit of sandpaper and take off that crusty edge where it builds up from the paint. So then I will flip it over and I will sand this down. This has not been sanded yet, so I just am rubbing those edges so some of that black is showing through. And I felt like this cafe stamp was just perfect. And I'm going towards the end of the bottom because of it being a Lazy Susan, and people actually might use it more than just for decor. They might actually have condiments or something on it. So I'm putting it towards the bottom. And then I'm using that Stays On ink and then just trying to kind of doing a 10 count, trying to let that paint be absorbed into each other. And then I will seal this in with some polycrylic, probably a couple coats since it is a Lazy Susan. If you're wondering what the stamp set was, this is the ones that I got from that scrapbook.com. And this is I See Paris. I just absolutely love it. This is similar to what I thought I was looking for when I got the IOD transfers that were similar to this, but I'm happy to find stamps. I absolutely love these ones. This was that perfect piece of wood that I didn't have to do anything to. What a godwink moment. I did glue those little feet on the bottom of it, chalk painted them white, distressed them, and now I'm just giving a little something something. And this doesn't really have a top coat, but I did sand it over. So I am just doing a couple little grain sack stripings, and I'm not going to go over the process with grain sack stripings. My goodness, you can do whatever your imagination is. In the same process of getting it many coats as it takes to I achieve the color I'm looking for, and then drying it in between. And so for this one, I did 3, and then the I See Paris has a little bitty bee, so why not? I had to use this little bitty bee. Do you guys even remember this tray? This was that pine tray, that balsam wood, or whatever type of wood it is, that just there's not a lot of structure to it. So just beefing it up with some black paint, a couple coats of polycrylic, just is taking it to another level. And then putting one of these tiles on it, people seem to like the tiles, so every time I do, they sell really well. So it is well worth the weeding, though I had to weed it and then put it on black because I was out of white vinyl, but it is what it is. And so then I tape around the side so I don't go up with the paint on the side. So I'm going to be using the multi-use in white with that same dry technique where I just have a little bit of paint on it and keep covering it until I achieve the coverage of the white that I'm looking for. So after getting those three coats of white on there, I am going to be using the assistance of that heat of the blow dryer to release that sticky and help me pull this vinyl off. And that'll help it so it doesn't pull all that previous paint off. And I'll take this one outside and give it a light misting of the polycrylic just to keep that white on there. Now that that polycrylic is dry, I can go in and I'm going to be distressing my edges. It's just a look that I like. So I'm going along with that 220 sandpaper and just distressing any of these sharp edges. And then I'll take some steel wool over the rest of the entire piece just to open up that polycrylic that's on there. To complete this little tray, I'm just going to finish it up with some folk art antiquing wax. This is what I have in my house. I know you're like, what? That's not Waverly. This is a bottle that I was given by a viewer. So I am using this up when I'm in the house and it works just as well as the antiquing wax. Though I didn't have any drop cloth and I'm using a napkin. I highly suggest something better than a napkin, but I only had one piece to antique. But I absolutely love when I do these tiles and white on black, how that like I said, it does sell really well for me. So I believe this is my last piece that I'm going to be detailing, and that is that Lazy Susan that had the flower on it. So I'm just removing the tape from where I painted that purple onto black, and I'm just taking off that crusty edge that builds up when you paint it from the tape. Now, if I was a wonderful artist, I could be painting another flower back on that, but I am not. So here I am at my Cameo silhouette, and I went to the design store and found this flower, and I thought that this flower would definitely complement the shape of this Lazy Susan, though it was made to be a card cutout. So I have to delete the parts of the card that I do not want. So I had to go in and release it from its compound and get all these other pieces and parts where it wanted to be a card. Hey, who knows? I just want that flower. And remembering to group it all back together before I move it and size it, or I'll just get pieces and parts. I'm glad that I felt that this flower complemented this Lazy Susan so well, because oh my goodness, it's like one of those mosaic tiles, those tiles, all the little pieces and parts that you get to weed. How are you all feeling about having to weed pieces and parts? But it sometimes is just worth the finished product. So I'm actually not going to try to like center this because it's not an exact match, and I knew that when I went to cut it out. So what I'm going to do is going to have it half on, half off, and I actually printed out multiples of this size. And so for just to show you guys, I'm just going to be putting two of them on, but kind of just eyeballing where that leaf pattern is on the edge. So though I painted the outer side black, I'm going in with the white multi-use. And the same exact thing that I've done with the white before on this video is going over multiple times to achieve the darkness of white. Is that a thing? Darkness of white? Okay. To I achieve the brightness of white. There we go. The brightness of white that I'm looking for. And then, yep, I'm using that blow dryer, though I have to say, trying to pull this off and hold a blow dryer with a Lazy Susan that spins is quite interesting. But see how doing the levels of white, doing that multiple coats of white just gave it the brightness of the white that I was looking for. So while I'm waiting for my silhouette to cut me out some more flowers, I have a few of these that are dry, and for this one, the polycrylic is all dry now, so I'm just taking some steel wool over it, making it nice and smooth, and then I'll finish it up with another protective coat of the Varathane finishing wax in the natural. So after doing all that beautiful detail, and I feel like these poor little bowls have just been left out just to be plain white, but the distressing is beautiful enough, and I know the people who will buy them will fill them up with beautiful decor. Yes, I will say sometimes it's hard not to put some kind of a stencil or a green stack striping on everything. But as a reseller, I have to remember that sometimes people just like things plain and they can add their own decor to these type of pieces. And I just absolutely love this grouping. I love two-toned. I love the black with the wood. And I absolutely love how those $5 dollar spot little two-tiered trays turned out. Definitely just something about black and those tiles when I put that antiquing wax over it. It just makes it pop, just gives it that nice aging. So I did play with a little bit of pieces of cardboard. I just wanted a little something to make that all tie that all together. So I had this little piece of something I had thrifted and I put a little antiquing wax, but I definitely think it fits into the bunny's new little home. So I absolutely love how this little Lazy Susan turned out. I love that green sack striping in the gray. I love the distressing of it all. Yeah, my stamp's a little bit off-centered, but you know, that's really hard to do in video for you all. And you know, you're probably thinking, why didn't she show us the bee when she stamped it on earlier in the video? Well, then you wouldn't have stayed to the end of the video if you saw everything before it was already done. Okay, I could not help myself when it came to that little bee and on these flowers. I did actually try to stamp it in white first, but it was so translucent that you couldn't really see it. But I do think it has a nice shadow effect to that black stays on.
So I thank you so much for watching today's video, and what did you think? Do you have any of these items laying around? Do you see them out in thrift stores? Have you passed them up? I hope I have inspired you to look at thrift store finds in a different way. And if you are part of my YouTube family, thank you so much. Your kind comments, your compliments, always being so supportive of me and Chris, just mean a lot. And if you're new to our channel and you like this kind of content, please consider hitting that subscription button along with the notification bell so you know when we've uploaded a new video.